Hey there, I hope that you're having an awesome day. This is Tuesday, almost the end of our month, our first month into 2020. And I think this really needs enough attention that maybe two videos needs to be done because of the fact that this, I believe, is the number one issue that makes people fail in business, is how they think about money. Now, yesterday we talked about, do you remember any specific phrases that your mother or your father or anyone else that you had direct contact with as you were growing up that would say things that would make you realize that money was something that was hard to get? And I believe that is something that a lot of people still believe. You know, we have, you know, a society in which we are told to work hard, go get a job, and then be happy with what you get, because that's probably the best you can expect. And that's not necessarily true, because we have examples around us all over the place of people that have succeeded even from a point where they were really seriously poor. Even right now, I'm not exactly where I want to be right now. I'm on the way, but I'm not there yet. But I do know that I have achieved already more than I could have possibly imagined when I was a little girl, because I grew up in a very poor situation. When I was about 6 or 7 years old, my father left our family, and my mother had been on her own, you know, just living at home, and he had good enough income, I believe, that she didn't need to work. But suddenly it became necessary for her to go and work. Luckily, she had gone to nursing school, and so because of that, she didn't finish. She'd got to the point where she, I don't know if she did 2 years or 3 years, but she was at a point where she could actually go in and work in a doctor's office. And she had the fortune that some of the early doctors that she worked for actually trained her in some of the procedures, such as, you know, x-rays and various different tests that nurses would take, especially in a private doctor's practice. And she had the opportunity to learn, in fact, get to a point where she was actually awarded an LPN. But she actually won that from the fact that she worked and kind of learned the practices of an LPN. Now, I don't know how much that has changed over the years, but that was one thing that she actually got the LPN pin. And I think it was actually that a doctor recommended her because of her skill level that she had achieved after a certain period of time. She also worked in many offices, in especially doctor's offices, because she had the opportunity to work in a, you know, to understand how a doctor's office might run. She also did the front end and sometimes the insurance. She learned a lot of different things, mostly just by pulling herself up by her bootstraps. But you could never say that she ever achieved anything close to being comfortable and rich. She barely managed to support us, but all through our lives, I don't remember any time ever feeling like we were in lack. Now, there were things I wanted and probably could, you know, she would always say she couldn't do it. But even Christmas time, she was able to, you know, buy a few nice things for each of us. She would generally put things on layaway. And, you know, that was when that was real popular. She might start it, you know, early in the year and just pay on it until she had paid it off and get it out just in time for Christmas. You know, things like coats, you know, that's when we'd usually get our coats. And she generally also got very good at sewing. And sometimes we'd have homemade gifts. So none of us actually felt like we were poor in the sense of being poor. But on the other hand, if we wanted things that were extravagant, we generally were told we could not have it because she couldn't afford it. And that was because the majority of the time, although she married more than once, we lived on her paycheck. As my daughter, my sisters and I, as we were growing up, that was our common situation. And when I first got married, I probably married someone very similar to some of the ones that she had married. And we lived hand to mouth a lot of the time. Now, my ex-husband, my first husband, the father of my children, was not very capable of being able to keep a job. And we went from job to job to job, sometimes many times a year. It could even be up to 20 times a year. And lots of spaces in between when there was no money coming in. He was not a really good manager of his money as well. And then, of course, that would be kind of bringing on that same basically lifestyle that I was used to as a child, that we were poor. We just barely got by. Now, we never got to a point where we were just so destitute and, you know, lost our house. We didn't own a house until just a little before we actually split up. And we moved up to Dacona, Colorado, which is north of Denver, about 30, 40 miles on the east side. It's in Weld County. And we actually bought a single-wide 14-foot trailer that had been put on land permanently. It was a kind of like a trailer park, but you actually owned the land around it, which wasn't much. You know, it was barely the yard patch, just like what usually happens with your house, too. You don't have a lot of land around your house anymore unless you pay extra, quite a bit extra a lot of the time. But we bought this trailer. It was not in very good condition. It had a great big hole in one of the bathrooms floors, and probably would fall apart if a heavy wind came and tried to blow it. But that was the closest thing to a house, and at that time I thought that was going to be the best I could expect. Of course, that isn't the best I could expect, because when we decided that we couldn't tolerate each other any longer and I wanted to be separate from him because of his physical and mental abuse, we moved, myself and my kids, we moved to Longmont, Colorado. You may have heard that name. That's a fairly large city in Colorado, still north of Denver. And in that city, we got an apartment. We had to have help from our church. Our church does do that in cases when families are in a bad situation. And I later actually applied for welfare. I've told that part of the story before. And I applied for welfare because I didn't have an income and he had cut us off from his money. He did not pay child support until he was forced to. And so when I actually applied for welfare and then later in that year applied for divorce, because he didn't do it, I started to do it. I ended up finding a lawyer that was paid, I think she was paid through the state, so she was like a welfare lawyer. I don't know what you call them, but basically she got paid through the state. And then later I even made my ex pay her fee. I don't know if he paid it or whether it just came from somewhere. But she basically gave him all of the rights and tax privileges because she just assumed that I would never come out of being on welfare, that I would live the rest of my life as a single mom on welfare. Now, maybe that's kind of statistically what would normally happen, but I couldn't see myself stopping there and that being my life. Now, we lived in Longmont. We were fairly happy there. And I met my second husband through my church affiliation because they have a singles program themselves. And we eventually, you know, after a rather short courtship, decided we would move back down into Denver. We found a house in the Aurora area of Denver, and then later bought a house of several miles from that house. And the reason why I'm telling this story is because you don't know if that's where you're going to end up. It might be your circumstances presently, but it doesn't mean that's where you're going to end up. And my ability to come here into the Denver area, Aurora is a huge city, and actually be in already a higher station just from going from being a mother that was on welfare. I actually was able to close all that down, and then they pushed him to, they basically garnished his wages, $100 per child. We have three children between us, and that was his welfare, I mean his child support for all the time while they were minor children. And I actually pushed for going off of the welfare and going on to the child support. Well, nobody told me this until it happened, but I actually had to have 1 month where I got neither, because they would take it away to make sure that I was on, you know, that I paid them back. You know how the state is. They don't look at a family situation and make it comfortable. They make it really hard. In fact, they really make it hard for people getting off of welfare. But I never saw myself as somebody that would stay on welfare. That was around a year and a half's time that I was on welfare, and the only time in my entire life. And what I know from that experience is I know how desperate and low and deep despair you can feel when you are that poor, when you have that, you know, you have bills, you need to pay for food, you can't do it because you don't have enough to go around. I know all of that. I've lived it and know how it feels. I also know how it feels to be upper middle class, which is what we've been over the years because of his paycheck, and then dropping that off because he stopped working. So I know how all of that feels. I know how it feels to be poor. But I also know that if you have the mindset that you just keep on thinking that you're poor and believing that nothing can happen to make it better and that you can't make it better, then you have already sealed the deal. And that is really important to understand. You cannot stop believing, and obviously you have to take real action. Now, maybe you don't have a lot of cash flow to create something, but you can create something if you make up your mind to do it. One of the early things I did before I was online doing business is we made dolls. We made really good money on those, and my husband would sell them. We would take them to fairs. We would go up into the mountains and just bring a bunch of them with us and sell them right on the street. One time we went to, I don't remember what city it was. It was a big fancy, I think it was a ski resort, very expensive town where people really are very rich. And we just brought like 10 dolls with us, and I think we went home with no dolls. We sold them right there on the spot. And, you know, when you decide that you are going to make something happen, then you just figure out something and you just go for it. You don't sit around thinking about how you can't. You just make up your mind you are going to do it. And that's what happened in that situation, is we sold those dolls until we just got tired of doing it, because we never had a problem selling them, although we probably didn't get what they were really worth. They were very high quality cotton stuffed dolls, and I made crocheted curls so they looked like Shirley Temple with great big flashy eyes that I embroidered on the doll's face. Someday maybe I'll pull one out and show you. I still have a couple of them around. I have one for sure around. And we just did that. My mother, for many years of being a great seamstress, made the old-fashioned little doll dresses for them. They were not Raggedy Ann. Raggedy Ann has ratty little, you know, like a mop head kind of hair, and that's not what we did. We had bows on them, and they had, you know, Mary Jane's shoes, I just, you know, created out of cloth, and we really went all out and made these dolls look very fancy. And that is the reason why I'm telling you this story, is instead of just sitting around saying, oh me, I'm poor, I found ways long before there was the internet, long before there was online business. And when you first got into like network marketing before the internet, the only way you got someone into your business is if you were willing to go and just like go to the grocery store and just start talking to people. Now, that's very, very uncomfortable. Very uncomfortable. And I bought leads and I had to make phone calls to talk to them. And I had just hit the phones day in, day out, all day long, from early morning till late at night. I did that for hours and hours and hours and hours. I don't even know how long I did that, for years. And I know that there is nothing that, that those things were hard. And making money on the internet compared to that is not hard at all. Not hard. I think people make things harder than they have to be. And I think it's all about, you make a decision. You just decide. Money is something that is a result, actually, of your mindset and what kind of action that you decide to take. It's not something that's magic. It is, in a sense, I guess, because it comes to you without you really expecting it. Like every time that I have gotten money that I didn't expect, it comes from a source I didn't know I was going to get it from. And it always makes it especially exciting when that happens. But when you get little emails that says you got this check or you got that check, and it just starts to flow, that happens because you make a decision in your head first. You stop letting yourself think that you're so poor that nothing can happen, nothing better for you. As I was rolling away in the car with my new husband, that we had just gone to Utah and gotten married in our temple over there, because our temple here in Denver wasn't built and finished. And we came back, got our stuff out of that apartment so that we could start putting it into the house that he had just rented for us in this town I live in now. And as I was rolling away and looking at the next door neighbor's apartment, she wasn't standing outside, but I was just thinking, she had been really, really mean and done really nasty stuff. She promised to babysit and then treated my kids like crap. She put sugar in my tank and called me all kinds of names. You know, those kind of people don't get what they want. You got to make a decision that you're not going to be bitter and nasty, that you're going to have gratefulness, and that you're going to take action. You're going to believe in where you're going, even if there's no evidence of it yet. That's what faith is. Faith is believing in something you don't have evidence of at this point, only that you believe it's coming to you. And then you're going to take the appropriate action to make it happen. Because it's not enough just to believe and then dream, but sit idle. You actually have to take some action. And you have to make some decisions that might be scary, like making an investment on something that you might be afraid to do. But you know that you've got to do something because your income needs to grow. And the only way it's going to is if you make a decision to take those actions and to make those investments and to change your mind so that you are ready to receive what it is you need to receive. And when you make those decisions, when you get to that place, and then those emails come to you that you made $1,000 today, that feels good. But it only happens if you decide to change how you're going to look at it. Are you going to be the old lady that's so angry at me, that she's so bitter that she put sugar in my tank or anything she could think of just to be nasty because she's so jealous, because she knows that she'll never have what she wants because she is so bitter that she repels people? It's real important for us not to be like that if we really want money to come to us. Money is a result of what we believe, the faith we have, the investment we take, and the action we take. When you add all that together, that's how money happens. It's not magic. It's all a formula. So I leave that with you today. I hope you have an awesome day. And if you found this of any kind of value, please like, comment, and share. And if you'd like to know how I'm making money on the internet in a simple and fun way, let's talk. Bye for now.